All right. Good evening, everyone. Good to see you in the house of the Lord tonight. And for the most part, you're sitting up. I won't ask you to move since you're sitting up as close as you are and all huddled together. And since James is already sitting up here, I certainly won't. No reason to even aggravate him tonight. Oh, well, thank you, Tony. Thank you. Thank you. let's go to the Lord in prayer as we open up this evening. Father, we just thank you tonight for the goodness of the Lord. We thank you for this week. Lord, every day that we live, every day that we breathe, Lord, is another day that we have to worship you and to serve you. Lord, we're reminded of your word that tells us, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. And we just want to praise you tonight. God, we don't have music tonight. We're not opening up with songs and singing, but God, we are going to open up with praise. And the instrument that we are going to use is the instrument of our hearts tonight to lift up worship and to lift up thanksgiving to you. And so, Lord God, we lift our hands and our hearts before you tonight. Lord, we thank you for the way that you moved in this service Sunday morning. And we thank you for the way that you moved in the service Sunday night. And Lord, we're believing that you're going to move tonight. Lord, it may be a different type, a different way of moving. God, every time you move, regardless of how it is, Lord, it is always accomplishing that you have seen fit for it to accomplish. And we just pray that you would touch tonight as we worship you. Lord, there are those that are watching us tonight by the internet and through Facebook Live. And Lord, I just speak tonight over them. Lord, I pray that you would just minister to their needs tonight. There may be some that are watching that are sick in their bodies that would be here if they could, that would love to be able to be out and about. But, Lord God, they're stuck and trapped where they are. But, Lord, we thank you for this medium. We thank you for this avenue that we can go into their homes. And we just pray tonight that the Holy Spirit of God would reach your hand out and would touch and would just establish your word in their heart. Lord, I'm reminded of your word that says that you sent your word and healed them. And I pray that tonight you would send your word to where they are and bring healing to them. And Lord, we ask you tonight as we get ready to go into the word of God, that you would just open up God's word to our understanding. Help us, Lord, to be receptive of the word of God. Help us to drink it in. Let it empower us. Let it be nurturing to us. Let it feed the very joints and marrow of who we are spiritually. And we pray this in Jesus' name. And the church said, amen and amen. Well, I want to talk to you tonight, and I had really planned on talking to you tonight and next Wednesday night on this subject. But let me just tell you, I went to see a surgeon today, and they have scheduled me to do surgery next Wednesday. So I'll be having surgery next Wednesday morning, and Joey will be here, and Mike Poole will be having surgery next Wednesday. I heard maybe we can be there together, Mike, hold hands across the OR. But Joey Tomlinson is going to be ministering to us next Wednesday night. He's home from Holmes, and so we're excited about him being here. We want you to come and just support Joey and just be here with him. And so I'll be back the following Wednesday. After that, I'll be back Sunday as well. But I want to talk to you tonight about walking in the supernatural. And really what I want to talk to you about is walking into a new year. As we begin to walk into 2017, I want us to look at walking into 2017 with a sense of expectancy that God is going to do miracles in our life and that God is going to bring the supernatural into our life. How many of you could use that? How many of you could use a supernatural touch of God in your life? And let me ask you this. How many of you really are truly expecting God to do some wonderful things in this upcoming year? Amen. Amen. I tell you, I believe that expectation is the key that unlocks the power and the grace of God. I am believing that. I'm believing for some divine healing to come into our home, into my home. I'm believing for some financial blessings to come into my home. And I'm believing for some divine healing to come into your homes and for some financial blessings to come into your homes and for household salvation to come into your homes. See, God blesses us in so many different ways, and we are believing that. So as we finish up, what we could very well say, and I could say this, what has been a trying year. I don't know about you. 2016 for you may have been a wonderful year, just a blessed year, just a year of bliss. But for me, 2016 and really 2015 as well, Both of them have been trying years. These last 2 years, you know, most of you know that our home has been plagued with sickness in the last 2 years. In fact, December the 26th, 2014 was the first attack that Amy had with this this thing, whatever it is that she has. And we've been dealing with that. And the first year was pretty bad, but honestly, this year has been a much worse year as far as that particular physical condition. And so, of course, the church has been flooded 2 years in a row. We've had some trying times. We've had some trying disappointments in our life over the last 2 years. And I'm not trying to focus on that as much as I'm trying to say I'm looking forward to leaving that behind and walking into some victory and walking into the miraculous in these upcoming days and upcoming months. Can you say amen to that? So we've experienced a series of rough years, and we've experienced storms, and we've experienced sickness, but now we're beginning to walk in the promises of God. We have a wonderful word from the Lord that God gave us in October, and I'm standing on that word. And so we want to walk in these promises, and we want to take our eyes off of what we see in the natural, and we want to refocus them on what we can see in the supernatural. That's something very important. I want you to hear what I'm saying. We've got to take our eyes off of what we see in the natural, and we have to focus them on the supernatural. You know, a wonderful way to do that is through prayer. If you'll really get with the Lord in prayer, when you don't pray, all you can see is what you can see. When you don't pray, all you can see is what's right before you. You can only see how many people are on the pew tonight. You can only see how much money you have in the bank. You can only see how much gas you have left in your car. You can only see how much mortgage or how many years are ahead of you on your mortgage. All you can see is what you can see. But if you'll ever get in a place of prayer, if you'll ever start spending some time with the Lord, if you'll ever start reaching out to Him, if you'll ever start praying and really getting in the Spirit, you begin to see past the natural and you begin to see in the supernatural. And that is the desire of this pastor, is for this church to walk in the supernatural, not to see what we can see in the natural, but to look past it. And I like this part, add His super to our natural. That's what I want to see us do. I want to see us add His super to our natural. Well, I want to talk to you a little bit tonight about the church and about the supernatural church. How many of you know that the church is a supernatural entity? The church, you know, there are two churches. There is the visible church. There is that church that we can see. There is the organization of church. There is the organization of religion. But there is an invisible church that is a spiritual entity that cannot be seen with the eyes of men, but is only experienced through the heart of God. And that church is the body of Christ. And the body of Christ is what I want to be part of. I know that we have to have the physical restraints of religion. I understand that there is the necessity of religion. There is necessity of organization. But what I really want to be part of is not so much organization as the invisible church, the supernatural church that operates in the power and the presence of God. I want you to go in your Bibles with me, if you will, tonight to 1 Peter chapter 2. I want us to read verses 5 through 9. So if you would, turn with me to 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 5 through 9, and Miss Anna might be able to get it for us on the screen. She does. They're right there. Hear the Apostle Peter speaking. He says, "You also, as lively stones," I want you to listen to the terminology, "as lively stones," and another version of the Bible says, "as stones that are alive," as stones which are living. "You, as lively stones, are built up a," what? "Spiritual house and holy priesthood to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. Wherefore also it is contained in the Scripture, 'Behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious, and he that believeth on him shall not be confounded. Unto you, therefore, which believe he is precious." How many of you believe that he is precious tonight? You believe in the preciousness of Jesus. "But unto them which be disobedient, The stone which the builders disallowed, the same is made the head of the corner, and a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense, even to them which stumble at the word, being disobedient, whereunto also they were appointed. Verse 9. But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, that you should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness and into marvelous light. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we ask you tonight, as we get ready to examine the Word of God, as we get ready to talk about the church and the fact that the church is not just a, it's not just a building, it's not an organization, it's not a 501c3, but the church is the expression of God's love to the world. It is the embodiment of the people of God that is constantly growing, that is constantly moving. It is the outlet by which the power of God flows into the world. It is the representation of who Christ is on the earth. And Lord, I pray tonight that you would help me by your Holy Spirit to be able to address this congregation concerning the duties of the church and the organization of the church and how the church has been set in order to do the work of the kingdom and how we have been called into a supernatural entity where miracles and signs and wonders take place. And I pray this in Jesus' name. And the church said, amen and amen. I asked you Sunday morning, or I said to you Sunday morning, aren't you glad that you go to a Pentecostal church? Aren't you glad you go to a place where the anointing of God is? Aren't you glad you go to a place where you can expect signs and wonders and miracles? And I tell you what, God touched us Sunday supernaturally. And then Sunday night, he touched again with his supernatural power. I know we live by faith and not by sight. And I know we walk by faith and not by feeling. But I want to tell you that I am very thrilled that I can feel him. I am very thrilled that I can touch him. I am very thrilled that I can be in a place where I can sense the power and the presence of the third person of the triune Godhead. Aren't you glad about that? Would you give the Lord praise if you're a lively stone tonight? Amen. Amen. I want to be in a place where I can feel and sense the life of God. Well, I want to look at for a little bit at this scripture, and really I just want to deal with verse number 5 tonight. Just verse number 5, where he says, you also as lively stones are built up a spiritual house. And you know, you really could get caught up on those words, lively stones. You know, there are some places that I go that are not lively stones. There are some churches that I preach in that are not lively stones. Samantha preaches out of the church a lot more than I do anymore. And she told me the other day, she said, Pastor, she said, I wish we could pack up the whole church and just take them on a tour and go around to different churches so they could see what church is like in other places, and they would appreciate the kind of church that we have. But you go to some places and you can't find a lively stone among the bunch. You can flip stones over and you won't find a lively one. But I want to just say this tonight and go on record and say, I appreciate this church and I appreciate you lively stones. I appreciate a place where I don't have to beg folks to say amen. I don't have to beg folks to clap their hands. You just do it because you love the Lord, and you're excited about the Word, and you're excited about the Spirit of God. Aren't you glad you're among some lively stones tonight? Amen. Amen. I'm glad to be with some lively stones. But as I said, we just want to look at this verse 5. You as lively stones are built up a spiritual house. In other words, not a house that is made of brick and mortar and stone, but a spiritual house, and a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. Now, here we find the pattern of the New Testament church. And here the Bible tells us that the New Testament church is one of supernatural origin. In other words, it was not built by man, it was built by God. It was not established by man. It was established by God. The church is spiritual. It is not carnal. It is not physical. It is spiritual. The church of the Lord Jesus Christ is a spiritual entity established by God. Peter tells us that we are part of a spiritual house. As you know, there's a song we used to sing that says, I'm in this church. I did not join. No, I was born. I had a new birth. You see, you didn't join the supernatural church. You are born into the supernatural church. It is sad that there are people that attend service even here, Sunday after Sunday, week after week, and they're part of the physical church because they joined Lake City PH Church, but they've never been born into the supernatural church. It is not something you can join. It's something you have to be born into. Is there anybody in the house tonight that would say, I'm born again. I've been born into the family of God. I'm part of the church because of a new birth. Amen. Amen. And so we are born into this house. Peter says, you are part of a spiritual house. Not just part of the house like people are part of a club, but you are actually the lively stones that make up the house. I'm wanting you to get this. I want you to get this in your spirit. This supernatural house is not built of wood and mortar. This supernatural house is not built of brick and stone. This supernatural house is made out of people. It is made out of souls. And Peter says, you are the building material in the house. You are the building material that God has used to build the house. He doesn't care about buildings. Listen to me, friend. He doesn't care about buildings. Now, this is the sanctuary. It has been set apart for the purpose of worshiping the Lord. But sometimes, and especially in the past, we've gotten really hung up on rooms that have pews in them. Especially in the past, we've got really hung up on rooms that have crosses hanging in them. And we make out like this room is more important than another room. Well, its importance is only because we have come together and said, this is the house of God, this is the church, and we ordain this room as a place of worship. But I want to tell you, when we're not here, this room is just a room. When we're not in it, it's just a room. God doesn't live here. He doesn't abide in this house. My children think that baptistry is God's bathtub, but that's not God's bathtub. No, he only comes when we're here, when we're gathered together. He said, when two or three of you are gathered together in the midst of them, I will be. And so this building is not the church. We are the church. So God is not building a house made with hands, but he is building a house made of those that he has redeemed. And let the redeemed of the Lord say so. I'm redeemed. Praise the Lord. Now, the first mention that I know of Jesus talking about the church, we find here in Matthew chapter 16, verse 18. It's one of those verses of scripture that if you've hung around church very long at all, you can quote Matthew 16, 18, and 19. It's kind of one of the founding scriptures that we know, especially we as Pentecostals. I would say it's one of our key scriptures. And this is what it says, Jesus speaking. And I say also unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And whatsoever, hallelujah, this is the supernatural part. And whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. And whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Hallelujah. What is that saying? That saying, whenever we get together, when we come together, when two or three come together and he's in the midst of them, he says, what I've done is I've made you a supernatural entity. And here's where the super is added to your natural. Whatever you do in the natural, I'm going to replicate it in the supernatural. Whatever you bind in the natural, I'm going to bind it in the supernatural. Whatever you loose in the natural, I'm going to
loose in the supernatural. If you bind up cancer in the natural, I'll bind it up in the heavens. If you bind up diabetes in the natural, I'll bind it up in the heavens. If you bind up sickness in the earth, I'll bind it up in the heavens. If you bind up divorce in the earth, I'll bind it in heaven. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. What you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. But not only that, if you'll release it on the earth, I'll release it in heaven. That's why I'm standing here today telling you that I decree and declare that 2017 is going to be a year of blessings. It's going to be the year of the supernatural. It's going to be a year of the favor of the Lord. Hallelujah. I decree and declare healing over your bodies. I decree and declare salvation over your homes. I decree and declare blessings on your businesses. Hallelujah. What you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. What you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. We're supernatural. Hallelujah. I was talking to James one day. He had called me. We were talking, and he said, there was a prayer that I had prayed. I prayed it on Monday, and God answered it on Sunday. I believe he probably had answered it before, but that was just when it took place to manifest. And so I told James. I told him what I prayed. And he said to me, he said, "What do you pray over me?" I said, "I pray God bless your home and God bless your family and God bless your business and God prosper your hand. If you want to know what your pastor's praying over you, that's what I'm praying over you. God bless your home and God bless your family and God prosper your businesses and prosper your affairs, whatever they may be, that God prospers your hand." Why? Because what I bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. What I loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Supernatural. Supernatural. Yes, we speak it. We speak it. And James, every time I drive down downtown and see you down there working, I say, "Praise God, prayers are working. Prayers are working." And you know what? When we passed you today, and I saw him down there, and I saw him, I said, "Lord, bless James. Just keep on blessing him." Listen, I'm telling you, I'm using him as an example, but I do that over you. I'm doing that over you. I receive your blessings. I receive your glory. I receive the supernatural in my life. Amen. Amen. We have power. We have power we've not tapped into. We're a supernatural house. He said, if you'll build it on this foundation, you'll have this particular power, that what you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, what you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. So now I want you to note this. Jesus says in verse 18, "I will build my church." Notice that Jesus takes on himself the responsibility of building his church. He realized that this particular project was too big to entrust it to any angel. It was too big to entrust it to any other heavenly being or even earthly being. So he said, "I will build my church." This is not a human project. This is a supernatural undertaking. And Jesus could trust no one to build his church other than himself. Now, God is the divine architect. And he has laid out the plan and the blueprint of the church. And we're going to talk in-depthly in just a minute about the role that Jesus plays in building the church, because it really can be kind of a complicated role and a little difficult to understand, but I hope that we'll be able to grasp it tonight before we're through. Let's go in our Bibles to Ephesians chapter 3, verse number 10. Ephesians chapter 2, verse number 19. Ephesians chapter 2, verse number 19. Jesus said, "I will build my church." But Even though Jesus has said, I'm placing it into my power and my order to build my church, Jesus uses what I call subcontractors. People that work under him. People that work under his authority.
You know, if Blake is building a house right now, and I don't even know who his contractor is. But when it's built, somebody will ride by and they'll say, look at that house that Blake and Andrea built. Because they built it. They signed the checks to have it built. And Blake is kind of a, how shall I put it? He's a micromanager to a certain degree. And you can see Blake. We have friends that live over in that neighborhood. And you could see Blake in the afternoons. He's down looking at that property. He's checking that line. I mean, that was before they even started building. He's looking, he's checking, he's making sure that property is set just right. It hadn't moved an inch. And so Blake has a general contractor. When that house is built, people will ride by and say, look at that house that Blake and Andrea built. And they very well may not have hammered one single nail or done any of the actual work, but you can believe their hand and finger is in everything that is going on in that house. And they're making sure that it is set up just to their specifications because it's a big investment and they are going to have a lot of money riding on it. And it's where they and their family are going to spend a long time. And so it's going to be just right. That's why they didn't buy a house that was already built. They could have probably spent less money and got a bigger house if they had bought one that was already built. But they said, no, we're going to build one, and it's going to be just how we want it. And that's the way Jesus did. He said, I'm going to build a church, and when it's done, it's going to be just like I want it. I may have to ride the contractor. I may have to make some phone calls. I may have to stay steadily on them. But when that house is built, it's going to be built just the way I intended it to be built. And so Jesus has some subcontractors that are part of this building contract. Look at Ephesians chapter 2, verse 19. Are you there? Now, therefore, you are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and of the what? Household of God. That's the church. And are built upon the what? The foundation of who? The apostles and prophets. Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom all the building fitly framed together groweth unto a holy temple in the Lord, in whom also are builded together for a habitation of God through the Spirit. Boy, that scripture says a lot right there. One of the main things it says is that Jesus is the chief cornerstone, and we're going to actually go back to that. But I just want you to note that. It says Jesus is the chief cornerstone. Now, here the scripture introduces for us two what I would call subcontractors. And who are they? Do you see them in the scripture? Say it out loud. The apostles and the prophets. Two of what I would call subcontractors. They are working for the Lord. They're in the employ of the Lord. They're under the payroll of the Lord. They're in the ownership of the Lord. But they are the subcontractors of this building project. Now go with me to Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11. And he, talking about the Lord, gave some apostles and some prophets
and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. For what purpose? For the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, and for the, what does that word edify mean? Building up. For the building up of the body of Christ. And the body of Christ is another word for the what? The church. The church. The body of Christ is another word for the church. Now, the apostles and prophets mentioned in Ephesians 2 and 20 are not the same as those listed in Ephesians 4:11. At least I don't think they are. The apostles and prophets mentioned in Ephesians 2 and 20 are the prophets of the Old Testament and the apostles of the New Testament. They are men like the Apostle Paul, the Apostle Peter, the Apostle John, the Apostle James. Men like Moses and Jeremiah and Isaiah and Ezekiel. They are the prophets and the apostles. They are the human authors, or I should say the human recorders of the Word of God. They are the human instruments in which God used to pen the Bible. And he says, on the foundation of what they have laid, I will build this church. Their foundation, what they put in holy writ, I will build the church. They are the originators. They are the original crew. When God laid the church out, and he said, I'm going to establish a church that the gates of hell cannot prevail against. And the Bible says holy men were moved on by the Holy Ghost. And they became the human autographers that autographed the Word of God, penned it, and put it into motion. And what they wrote has been established forever. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall never pass away. Would somebody give God praise for his word tonight? So the apostles and the prophets mentioned in Ephesians 2 and 20 are not the same as the apostles and prophets mentioned in Ephesians 4:11. Paul is saying in Ephesians 2 and 20, these words that were written are the word of God, and on that lays the foundation of the church. But in Ephesians 4:11, Paul is referring to the fivefold ministry. And this is the continual group that is anointed by the Holy Spirit, who speaks for God to the church for the purpose of equipping the saints and building up the body of Christ. So I want you to think of it like this. The first group, the Ephesians 2 and 20 group, it was by the mouth of God that they laid the foundation and they built the structure and they set the pillars and they put in the load-bearing walls and they put up the trusses and the beams that support the weight of the house. Do you understand what I'm saying? They are the ones that laid the structure of the house. And when they were through, the structure was complete. When they were through, the structure was done. It was a finished project as far as the structure. There would be no more foundations. There would be no more room additions. There would not be a second story put into the structure. When they were done, the structure was complete. Do you hear what I'm saying? So they are a different group, and they are held to a different standard, and they are of a different nature than those of us that are part of the fivefold ministry. Say, preacher, why are you saying that? Because we live in a day, especially in the charismatic world and in the Catholic world, where preachers and priests and apostles feel that they can come behind the record of this book and rewrite and reorganize and regroup and tell you things that are in addition to this book. I saw today a man, I didn't even read it, I didn't even read the article, but I saw where a man posted today that a Catholic bishop was doing an interview, and this Catholic bishop said that hell was conjured up, and said why the church conjured up hell. Well, I didn't even give him the respect to read the article. But that is the kind of dangerous thing that we are dealing with today when people think they have the right and the authority to change the Holy Word of God. The Word is the Word. It is what has been written has been established, and it has been established forever. Amen. So this group has been established, has come to be those that did the original laying, the original framework of the house, so to speak. Now, I want you to think of the other group like this, that group of apostles, prophets, pastors, teachers, evangelists. I want you to think of them like this. I want you to think of them like plumbers, painters, electricians, decorators, and housekeepers. Your plumber, your electrician, they are maintenance folks. Right now, we're in need of some plumbing. My brother told me the other day, he said, boy, I'm glad you have a house with three toilets in it, because only one out of the three was functional at that particular time. And so we're in need of some plumbing. How many of you know it's not always an easy job to find a plumber? I don't want him to come in and build me a new bathroom. I just need him to unclog a toilet. I don't want him to come in and have to build me a brand new addition and put in a new shower and all these things. I just want him to come in and to unstop a drain or two. I've got a dishwasher. I don't know that. I'm telling you, some of you real saintly folks, people like you, Miss Pam, you need to come to my house and lay hands on my dishwasher. There's a devil in it, I'm telling you. That dishwasher is it is getting the best of me. I need a plumber. I said, I wonder if the plumber even knows how to work with this thing. I don't need him to put on an addition. You understand what I'm saying? But there are some upkeep things that house needs. That house that I live in, and I love my house, but it was built in 1958, and it's got a great foundation. Before we built it, the building inspector came out and looked at it, and he told me, he said, man, this house is more solid and built better than about any brand new house you'll ever find today. It is built as solid as one can be built, and he gave great praises over the house. But even though the house was built solid, it still was built in 1958. And it's got some age on it. And over this process of time and over this age, some things have broke down and some things need fixing and some things need repairing. During the summertime, the heat of the outside and the heat of the attic mixes with the air conditioning, causes the walls to sweat and causes mildew and stuff to collect. And we have to fix that and take care of that. Well, I want to tell you, this grand old church that we're in, it also has some age on it. And in this church, it's got some outside sources that blow against it. And in this church, it has some outside elements that try to come in and try to damage it. And in this church, there are some clogged up sinks and some clogged up toilets. And there's some electrical panels that need to be fixed and replaced. And God said, I've built a church and established one that will stand here forever. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to put within that church prophets and apostles and pastors and teachers, and they will be here for the maintaining and the maintenance of my word. Apostles have not been called and prophets have not been called to change the word of God. We none have the right to make changes to the word of God. Let me say that again. There's no one living that has the right to make any changes to the word of God. My job as a pastor, my job as an apostle, my job as a prophet, my job as a teacher is not to make changes to the Word of God, but it is to help reveal the plan of God and to reinforce it. Now, at times, years go by and styles change. And if you're like me, your house will look the same from year to year until the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. But my wife could change. My house has four bedrooms. There's only one that has not been my bedroom. I have lived in three different bedrooms in my house, and a couple of them multiple times, because she'll just decide one day she wants to move, and we'll pack up and move. And the room that is my master bedroom right now currently has its third flooring on it, and we've only lived there for 7 years. It was carpeted. Carpet came up. Then we put down flooring. The flooring, we heard, we don't know, but we heard, was emitting poisonous gas. And so one night I came in and she's ripped the flooring up and tossing it into the yard. And so for months, the flooring in my bedroom has been plywood and the old hardwood floor that was left there until just last week. Praise and glory to God. I feel like a rich man. I'm standing on brand new carpet and not walking on plywood in the mornings. Well, I didn't need a brand new contractor to do that. I didn't need them to pour me a new foundation to do that. But I did need some folks that knew how to lay carpet and knew how to do what needed to be done in order to maintain. Because sometimes style changes, and wives don't want to live in the 1970s when it's the 2010s. Amen. And so guess what? Our children don't want to live in the 1970s when it's the 2010s. And so God says, you are not allowed to mess with the structure. You cannot mess with the structure. The trusses stay where the trusses were laid. The pillars stay where the pillars were laid. The load-bearing walls stay where the load-bearing walls were put. And the foundation stays exactly the same. But if you want to paint the walls, have at it, honey. If you want to put in a ceiling fan, go ahead. If you want to take out lights and put in new lights, then do it. If you want to lay carpet or hardwood or laminate flooring, go for it. You know what I'm saying? I'm saying that the methods change, styles change, things change. And so God raises up apostles and prophets and pastors and teachers, and they are the plumbers and electricians and the decorators. And they come and they say, you know what? If this house is going to grow and this house is going to be comfortable for the new generation that is coming in, then there are some changes that we have to make to provide for that next generation that is coming in. But those same apostles and prophets and pastors and teachers that serve as electricians and plumbers and decorators also stand there with axes in hand and say, nobody will touch the foundation. Nobody will change the trusses, because the second that the foundation is moved at all, the second that the load-bearing walls are taken out, the second that the pillars are removed, that structure that was the church in that moment ceases being the church. And there are some houses of worship today that are no longer the church. People still gather together. People still dress up. People still come with Bibles in hand. But they've changed the way of salvation. And they've changed the doctrines of the church. They've changed the pillars. And when they did, that house ceased being supernatural. It ceased being the church. I preached in a church several years ago, and the church through the years was once a powerful, thriving, supernatural entity. And through the years, it's become dry and dead and formal. And I preached that night on the baptism of the Holy Ghost, and it was so dead, it was like preaching to these pews. I left there and I said, I don't care what they offer me, I would never come pastor this place. In fact, I don't even want to ever come back here and preach again. It was that dead. And as we were walking out, Jay and I believe Ryan was with me at that time, and as we were walking out, Jay heard one of the men on the cell phone, and he said, man, you should have been in church tonight. It was like this church was 30 years ago. And I thought it was dead as a doornail. You see, it is the job of the pastor, the prophet, the apostle, the evangelist, the teacher, to be the electrician and to make sure that the house has power. Oh. Hallelujah. One of the greatest responsibilities that I have as your pastor is to make sure this place has power. And there are times that it would be so easy, and you've heard me say it before, it would be so easy just to go through the day and do nothing. Just let it pass. But there are times like this past Sunday morning. It wasn't your fault. It wasn't your fault. The devil was at work. He was in the atmosphere. He was trying to block the worship. He was trying to block the spirit. He was trying to block praises from going forth. And so I thought, Lord, I would much rather just sit here, just listen to them sing, and get up and preach. I've got a good sermon, just let me preach. But it was not about my sermon being preached. As a pastor, it was also my job that God would say, this is my house. An electrician, when you see the lights aren't working, you need to get them fixed. When you see the lights aren't working, you need to replug the power. You need to reconnect the power. When you see that the drains are stopped up, when you see the plumbing's not at work, it is the job of the pastor. It is the job of the prophet. It is the job of the apostle. It is the job of the evangelist. It is the job of the teacher to act in the maintenance mode. It is our job to keep the house of God in functionality and supernatural. This is the work. This is the work of the fivefold ministry. It's not changing the structure of the church. It's not making it more appealing to the world, but it is making sure that the power of God is flowing, that the pipes are flowing, that the house is functional. No preacher can redefine salvation. No preacher can redefine salvation. No preacher can redefine what holiness is. And no preacher can redefine the fundamentals of Christianity. They have been set, and it is not our job to define them. It is our job to preach what is already there. Amen. It is the job of the preacher to preach what has already been laid by the apostles and the prophets. Styles change, methods change, music changes. We do things in many different ways, but the content of the book never changes. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 9. For we are laborers together with God. You are God's husbandry. You are God's building. According to the grace of God, which is given unto me as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation, and another buildeth thereon. But let every man take heed how he builds thereupon. For other foundation can no man lay than that that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Hallelujah.
Now, we're going to come back to that in verse number 11, but let's first of all look at verse number 9. You may say, preacher, if you are the plumber, and aren't you glad I'm only the plumber spiritually? And if you are the electrician, and aren't you glad I'm only the electrician spiritually? But say, if it's your job, if that's your job to do the maintenance work around the house spiritually, what is my role as a member? Glad you asked me. You, the members of the body, play a part in the building of the supernatural. Now I want to show you three things that the Bible says that you are. Number one, he says that you are the laborers. Look at that. You are the laborers. What does he mean? He means you are the ones that go out and have the responsibility of sharing the message of Christ and gathering the people. Amen. Did you know that's not my responsibility? Did you know that's not the responsibility of the fivefold ministry to go and gather the people? No, I've already told you what our responsibility is. Your responsibility is to be a laborer. And your responsibility is to go into the highways and byways, to go into the hedges and compel people to come in. It is your responsibility to invite your neighbors and your friends. It is your responsibility to invite your family, your cousins, your aunts, your uncles. It is your responsibility to provide the building material for which God is building this church. That's the role you play. You're a laborer in this house, and you should be busy at work every single week inviting new people to come to the house of the Lord. Now, I'm not saying that I'm nullified from that because I'm still a member of the church. So like you, I should also be inviting people. But I'm saying it's not my sole responsibility. It is all of us working corporately together to reach the lost. And then notice what he says. He says, you are the laborers. You are God's husbandry. What does that mean? In other words, you are God's field. It is your job to gather. It is your job to preach in the highways, to compel people to come in. But it's also your job to receive the word of God inside of you. And it is your job to have a heart that is receptive of the word of God. Remember that when Jesus talked about there were four grounds, one was stony, one was thorny, but he said there was one that was receptive. There was one that was open. There was one that was receptive to receiving the seed, which is the word of God. And that is part of your job as members in particular in the body of Christ, to be open to receive the word of God, to be open to receive what God is saying, because God is building you up, and in building you up, he's building the church. I'm telling you, you ought to be excited about getting seed inside of you, because that's part of your function in the body and in the building of the church, is to receive the seed. And then thirdly, we are the material of the building. Notice what he says. You are the laborers. You are the husbandry. You are God's building. You are literally the material in which God is using to build the church. Now, let's talk about this. Give me about five more minutes, and I will close. What is the role of Jesus in his church? I've already talked about the role of the apostles and prophets. We've talked about the role of the current fivefold ministry. And we've talked about your role as members of the body of Christ. But Jesus has given himself a number of different functions within the body. Notice in Matthew, he said he was the builder. He said, upon this rock, I will build my church. So he was the builder. But also, he said that
Paul said that he's laid the foundation that's already been laid as the wise master builder. He said, I've laid a foundation, and that foundation is Jesus. So Jesus is the builder, but he's also the foundation. When Jesus said to Peter, upon this rock I'll build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it, he was saying, upon this foundation I will build my church. What was the foundation that he was talking about? He was talking about the foundation of the revelation of Jesus Christ. What is the revelation? Jesus was more than a man. Here is the foundation upon which the church is built. Jesus Christ is God. And Jesus Christ is the only way to God. That's the foundation. Jesus Christ is God, and Jesus Christ is the absolute only way to God. And he said, that's the foundation. That was the revelation that Peter had when he said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And it was the revelation by which the wise master builder, the Apostle Paul, who was one of those apostles and prophets, laid. And then Jesus says this, that he also, or the word says this, that he also is the cornerstone. In other words, he's the plumb line. He is the one by which everything is fitly joined together. There is one subject that cannot be exhausted. Did you know that you could probably preach too much on the Holy Ghost? And I probably have. Did you know that you could probably preach too much on holiness? Did you know that you could probably preach too much on about any subject in the Bible? Did you know you could probably exhaust the subject of tithing? Did you know that you could exhaust the subject of fasting? Did you know you could exhaust the subject of miracles? You could exhaust the subject of tongues and interpretation. You can exhaust the subject of the gifts of the Spirit, but there is one inexhaustible subject in the Bible, and his name is Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He cannot be emphasized enough. He cannot be preached about enough. He cannot be exalted enough. He cannot be praised enough. He cannot be worshiped enough. He cannot be loved enough. For he is the cornerstone. Amen. Stand to your feet. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Jesus commissioned his church to be built in the Great Commission, when he said to go into all the world and make disciples of all people. The message that Jesus is God coming to the world to redeem the world through his death and resurrection is literally the foundation of all we believe. Jesus is the cornerstone. Jesus is the Word made flesh. And all we know and all we trust and all we honor is in the Word of God. Amen. I want you to hear what I'm saying as I close tonight. We are living in a time in which people are claiming to believe in Jesus, but not believe in the infallibility of this book. We are living in a time when people claim to love Jesus but not believe everything the Word says about him or everything the Word says about righteousness and holiness and morality. And I'm telling you that you cannot have both. You will either believe all this book has to say, or you might as well not believe anything this book has to say. For it is the foundation of the apostles and the prophets by which everything stands. How do I know Jesus is the Son of God?
This book told me so.
How do I know Jesus died on a cross to save me of my sins?
This book told me so.
How do I know that it is the blood that cleanses and the blood that redeems?
This book told me so.
So if this book is wrong about same-sex relationships, then couldn't this book also be wrong about Jesus being the Son of God? And if this book is wrong about sex outside of marriage being a sin, then could it also be that this book was wrong about Jesus being the only way to heaven? And if this book is wrong about all the other things that people want to divorce and throw away, then who is to say that this book is not wrong about who it says Jesus is? So if I'm going to accept what it says about Jesus,
then I've got to accept everything that it says.
Amen?
For it is the foundation by which everything stands.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So if we're going to walk in the supernatural, we've got to understand that God has a supernatural plug. He's got a supernatural source. He's got a supernatural revenue. And it is the living church of the living God. And I'm a part of it, I am.
Hallelujah!
I'm a part of it, I am. Glory to God. You need to teach your children that they have supernatural favor. You need to teach your children they're part of a supernatural entity called the church.
The other night, Olivia was telling us that she had seen a little dark figure some time ago. Says she saw it in our room. I don't know if she had a dream or what. I don't know if she saw something supernaturally or she was just dreaming. But she said that some time ago, she said, I was laying in the bed with you and Mama. And she said, the little figure went from your side of the bed and went around to Mama's side of the bed. And she said, I didn't know what to do then. This is coming from a four-year-old. She said, I didn't know what to do then. She said, but now I know that I just say to him, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus.
And I've told her that, but I didn't know what was about to come out of her mouth next. And then she said, because I'm covered in the blood of Jesus. Hallelujah. She told us that, what was it, two nights ago. She said, I'm covered in the blood of... We serve a supernatural God. And our children need to know who they are. Hallelujah. And what they have and what they possess in Christ.
Take each other by the hand as we close tonight in prayer. I'm sorry, folks. I've just about preached myself happy in these last few minutes.
Hallelujah. I know some of you need to go home and go to bed. God, I just pray that you'll strengthen them for the journey. Lord God, I pray when Blake gets up in the morning at 4 o'clock, let him feel like he's rested for many, many hours. Lord God, I pray for some of these that are having to get up so early, but they've made the journey to be in church tonight. I pray that you just supernaturally touch them and infuse their bodies with strength. But Lord, I say tonight, this house is covered in the blood of the Lamb. We're covered in the blood of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Touch this house and touch these people. Lord God, I speak and declare and decree that blessings are coming their way. The supernatural is being released in their life. In Jesus' name. And this church, the Lake City Pentecostal Holiness Church, is going to operate in the supernatural like it never has in its 80 years of living. It's going to operate in the supernatural. I declare it in Jesus' name. Amen, and amen, and amen. Hallelujah. 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 I want you to come back into this house Sunday morning a lively stone. We've got a Christmas concert that we're going to do Sunday morning. Sister Jan Standridge is going to be doing it about 20 minutes or so before I get up to preach. I want her to say, what in the world happened to those folks at Lake City PH? I want you to be a lively stone here Sunday morning. Amen. God bless you. You are dismissed in the name of the Lord.